find our seats again this morning. I'm going to read the words of Psalm 130 from the Revised Standard Version. Out of the depths I cry to thee, O Lord. Lord, hear my voice. Let thy ears be attentive to the voice of my supplications. If thou, O Lord, should mark iniquities, Lord, who could stand? But there is forgiveness with thee, that thou mayest be feared. I wait for the Lord, my soul waits, and in his word I hope. My soul waits for the Lord, more than watchmen for the morning. O Israel, hope in the Lord, for with the Lord there is steadfast love, and with him is plenteous redemption, and he will redeem Israel all his iniquities. Now for the children will come forward. For the children will come forward. Karen. We allow children of any age.
Rock right up against the wall of the Dairy Queen. And I don't know what made me pick up the rock. But a little voice in my head said, pick up the rock. Have you ever found a rock like this? No. Did you pick it up? Yeah. So on the one side, it's got the date, 2018. On the other side, it says, rock my way, keep or rehide. I'd seen on Pinterest, I go on there and look for things. I'd seen they had all these rock painting ideas, so I thought, well, I'm going to check into this and see what this is all about. And I just happened to get a magazine about the same time with an article about rock painting. And come to find out, it's a project called Kindness Rock Project. It began in 2015 as the group's founder, Megan Murphy, walked the Sandy Neck Beach in Barnstable, Massachusetts, collecting rocks. Now, hundreds of groups around the world are involved, painting rocks with inspirational messages and hiding them in public places for others to find. The group's goal is simple: to inspire others to spread kindness in their communities. Because one message at just the right moment can change someone's entire day and their outlook on life. So, I painted some rocks. And there, once again, I went to Pinterest to find, what am I going to paint on this rock? And I saw this rock that said, he is my rock. Well, I didn't have to look any further. That's what I was going to paint on my rock. And I felt like I needed to paint something pretty on the other side to get people's attention too. So, along with the theme, I painted a cross with a little red heart to remind people of God's love and what he gave for us. So I've got a little bag of rocks for you to take with you today. You can keep one to remember to be kind at school or anywhere you go. And the other one, take it with you somewhere you go frequently, and leave it where someone else can find it, and maybe it'll be just the message that they need for that day. So can we hold hands and say a quick prayer? Dear God, thank you for bringing these children today. Thank you for listening to our prayers, and thank you for being kind. You were the originator of the Rock Project. Be with these children as they start a new school year. And let them leave their rock where someone can find it that needs your love. Amen. Thank you.
God is our rock and salvation. And as we stand to sing this song, there are images of God around. See if you can see some of those. King of love, living water.
Nothing like it, I am there. This is my story. This is
Lord, I think we need to hear those words again, though we may speak with bravest fire and have the gift to all inspire and have not love. Our words are vain, as sounding brass and hopeless gain, though we may give all we possess in striving so our love to profess. But if they're not given by love within, the prophet soon turns strangely thin. Come, Spirit, come, our hearts control. Our spirits long to be made whole. Let inward love guide every deed. By this, we worship and are free. Indeed, we have come to worship, to give our gifts, but also to renew the acceptance of that gift that God has given to us. For we know that even as we lift our needs, our prayers of healing, forgiveness, prayers of being in relationships that are acceptable to Him, our prayers that we might worship in spirit and truth, we know that they mean so much more as we have accepted God's love and God's truth into our hearts, and from our hearts come all of the actions that we take with our families, with our neighbors, with our response to all of the difficulties of the world. We try to live as Jesus lived. And we pray the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples, which we are to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
First of all, a word of thanks for all of your prayers and acts of kindness and for your cards. I ended up with a PCL injury, a ligament on the backside of my knee that mostly footballs and soccer players get. And also people that are in car accidents where their dashboards come in and hit their legs. But thank you for your prayers. It's going to be a slow journey, but I'm hoping to avoid surgery. So I can use your continued prayers. I invite you now to be in prayer as we begin our sermon. O Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, you who are our rock and our redeemer. How many of us here this morning are planners? Quite a few of us. All right. Well, you're going to get past me because I'm a planner too. And you know how to make God laugh. Tell him your plans. Christians, we have a plan for us that begins at our baptism. For those of us that feel at ease, when we have plans in our midst and we feel secure to move forward, it drives a planner nuts when somebody else is in charge and there doesn't seem to be a plan. But guess what? God's in charge of our lives, and the plan for us begins at our baptism. At baptism, in the the words of Ephesians, we're marked with a seal. And we put aside the old self and claim the new self that we have through Christ. Those letting go and those putting on actions are a part of the way that you and I are moving forward in our life. And I want us to hear the words from Ephesians, beginning at chapter 4. And we continue on into the second chapter 5. Therefore, putting away falsehood, let everyone speak the truth with his neighbor, for we are members one of another. Be angry, but do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger. And give no opportunity to the devil. Got a declaration there. Let the thief no longer steal, but rather let him labor, doing honest work with his hands, so that he may be able to give to those in need. Let no evil talk come out of your mouths, but only such as is good for the edifying, as fits the occasion, that we may impart grace to those who hear. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, in whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and slander be put away from you with all malice. And be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, as God in Christ forgave you. Therefore, be imitators of God as beloved children, and walk in love as Christ loved us, who gave himself up for us, a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. In that passage, the author of Ephesians talks a lot in a positive way what we should be doing. The book of Ephesians was written, we believe, by not Paul himself, but someone very close to Paul who wanted to sum up his teachings and to be very practical in how we live out being disciples. He comes to it from a community of faith, but how the individual contributes to the community of faith. When I was early in my ministry, I shared a backyard neighbor of a family by the name of the Tinsleys. When I moved there, the Tinsleys had an 11-year-old daughter and 2.5-year-old quadruplets. Hello. they're a wonderful family, and I learned so much. I think I learned more from them than they ever learned. Church. Church was an experience with 2.5-year-old quadruplets. There were 3 boys and 1 girl, and the 3 boys would crawl under the pews, and if you weren't aware of them, it would kind of be startling to have someone brush up against your calves as they were moving through the congregation. But they each had their own particular favorite surrogate grandparent. Congregation, and they knew right where they were always sitting, because you know we Methodists were creatures of habit, right? And they would crawl back and they would curl up either under the pew where their favorite surrogate grandparents were, or they'd curl up and sit beside them or lay beside them in the pews. But Beth, the little girl, she would crawl up to the pulpit and she would wrap around one side of the pulpit, looking up at me and sucking her thumb. And almost every week I put her to sleep. her parents kept assuring me it was the soothing sound of my voice. I'm not so sure. I think it was the content. But one time, and I believe it was a Saturday morning, I was going to be dropping something By this time, the quads were 5 years old. They were just going into kindergarten, and their older sister was now 16 and driving, which was a huge help to mom and dad. But my plan was just to go in quickly and leave because it was breakfast time, and I knew that it had to be a crazy time, because breakfast growing up in my house was always crazy. And I walked in, and there was just this peace. And I'm thinking, can I come to the right house? And what it was, as I observed, you know, apparently they had a routine. You know, one of the quads would set, you know, the plates out. One of them handled the utensils. Another one brought the cups. Mom and Dad were bringing the food over to the table. And they all had something to do. And they listened to one another as they shared their meal. They were kind. It wasn't like the Pokemon clan where we would talk over one another all the time. It was this utter calm. And then the reverse happened, where I cleared the table and dishes got put in the dishwasher, and then they went back to their rooms, and the father of the Tinsley said that they were making their beds. And I can remember all the threats that were made to me, because that was one of my least favorite tasks to do. I thought, it doesn't make sense, you're going to mess it up again soon. But anyway, as I observed them, and I started asking some questions, like, what's a school day morning like? And Mrs. Tinsley talked about how the night before, the kids were now old enough that they could make decisions about what they were going to have in their brown bag lunches, and they would make the lunches and put them away. Dad would help them pick out outfits and get those set aside. And I'm like, oh my goodness. I said, how do you do this? And Mrs. Tinsley said that growing up, she experienced much of what I did growing up, that it was chaos getting ready for school. And it was chaos when we got home. And she said,